Brown Wolf by Jack London. Narrated by Adam Verner. She had delayed because of the dew-wet grass in order to put on her overshoes, and when she emerged from the house, found her waiting husband absorbed in the wonder of a bursting almond bud. She sent a questing glance across the tall grass and in and out among the orchard trees. "Where's Wolf?" she asked.
"He was here a moment ago."
Walt Irvine drew himself away with a jerk from the metaphysics and poetry of the organic miracle of blossom and surveyed the landscape.
"He was running a rabbit the last I saw of him."
"Wolf, Wolf, here, Wolf," she called, as they left the clearing and took the trail that led down through the waxen-belled manzanita jungle to the county road. Irvine thrust between his lips the little finger of each hand and lent to her efforts a shrill whistling. She covered her ears hastily and made a wry grimace.
"My, for a poet, delicately attuned and all the rest of it, you can make unlovely noises. My eardrums are pierced. You outwhistle..."
"Orpheus?"
"I was about to say a street Arab," she concluded severely.
"Poesy does not prevent one from being practical. At least it doesn't prevent me. Mine is no futility of genius that can't sell gems to the magazines."
He assumed a mock extravagance and went on.
"I am no attic singer, no ballroom warbler. And why? Because I am practical. Mine is no squalor of song that cannot transmute itself with proper exchange value into a flower-crowned cottage, a sweet mountain meadow, a grove of redwoods, an orchard of 37 trees, one long row of blackberries and two short rows of strawberries, to say nothing of a quarter of a mile of gurgling brook."
"Oh, that all your song transmutations were as successful," she laughed.
"Name one that wasn't."
"Those two beautiful sonnets that you transmuted into the cow that was accounted the worst milker in the township."
"She was beautiful," he began.
"But she didn't give milk," Madge interrupted.
"But she was beautiful now, wasn't she?" he insisted.
"And here's where beauty and utility fall out," was her reply. "And there's the wolf."
From the thicket-covered hillside came a crashing of underbrush, and then, 40 feet above them, on the edge of the sheer wall of rock, appeared a wolf's head and shoulders. His braced forepaws dislodged a pebble, and with sharp, pricked ears and peering eyes, he watched the fall of the pebble till it struck at their feet. Then he transferred his gaze and, with open mouth, laughed down at them.
"You wolf, you,"
and "you blessed wolf,"
the man and woman called out to him. The ears flattened back and down at the sound, and the head seemed to snuggle under the caress of an invisible hand. They watched him scramble backward into the thicket, then proceeded on their way. Several minutes later, rounding a turn in the trail where the descent was less precipitous, he joined them in the midst of a miniature avalanche of pebbles and loose soil. He was not demonstrative. A pat and a rub around the ears from the man, and a more prolonged caressing from the woman, and he was away down the trail in front of them, gliding effortlessly over the ground in true wolf fashion. In build and coat and brush, he was a huge timber wolf, but the lie was given to his wolfhood by his color and marking. There the dog unmistakably advertised itself. No wolf was ever colored like him. He was brown, deep brown, red brown, an orgy of browns. Back and shoulders were a warm brown that paled on the sides and underneath to a yellow that was dingy because of the brown that lingered in it. The white of the throat and paws and the spots over the eyes was dirty because of the persistent and ineradicable brown, while the eyes themselves were twin topazes, golden and brown. The man and woman loved the dog very much. Perhaps this was because it had been such a task to win.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.